In today's episode, I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to tell you about the time I met Mr. Sandeep Goyal. Now, who is Mr. Sandeep Goyal? Funny little coincidence, Mr. Sandeep Goyal and I went to the same school. The guy has a knack for taking companies out of the stratosphere. So now, why am I telling you about Mr. Sandeep Goyal? He was a small town guy like I am, and he had, you know, dreams of the moon. Basically, has a very simple mental model. It's called the big game mentality, which separates small businesses from big businesses. Now, he described this mental model with a very simple analogy. Now, Mr. Goyal, being born in India and a fan of cricket, described his mental model with a very simple analogy. He goes, Paul, when a batsman goes up to the pitch and is surrounded by thousands of fans and is able to focus on the ball and hit a sixer, cue Yuvraj hitting six sixes.
That's huge. Six ball. He's raining sixes here. Kingsmead, there's another. Make a difference. It doesn't. Five. As you like. Here he goes again. Last ball of the innings. And he's put it away. Oh, has he?
Yeah. But wasn't that such a lovely treat to watch Yuvraj hit six sixes. As part of his mental model, which distinguishes small businesses from big businesses, he described that a lot of individuals overlook some very basic things like punctuality, having proper business cards for, you know, representation in IRL. I mean, this was 10 years ago. So having a digital presence, which is basically hygiene in 2021, rewarding somebody on your team when they perform, which goes to the culture aspect. So in a nutshell, what is Mr. Sandeep Goyal actually saying? Number one, focus. Be razor sharp focused on your vision. Number two, don't ignore the small stuff. The little details matter. The little things that you do go a long way in cementing how people perceive you as a business. Now, this conversation with Mr. Goyal reminded me of the keynote I saw of Steve Jobs when he returned to Apple, where he talks about vision and focus. Now let's take a look at this video together because one, it's an amazing masterclass in vision, focus, strategy, and two, because I'm an Apple fanboy. There's bias. Yes, there's a bias, but doesn't take away from the fact that there's some good, juicy stuff here. Now, even though this talk is over two decades old, it boils down strategy to its most essential parts, the who, the why, the what. What are we going to focus on and what are the things we're not going to do? Who do we care about? What are we doing well? And what are the things that we should build on? And what are the partnerships? What are the alignments that we should capture? And what are the things that we should not do at all? What are the bridges that we need to build? And what are the bridges that we need to burn? Who are the customers that love us and build for them? The fundamentals still remain true today.
What about OpenDoc?
What about OpenDoc?
Yeah.
Yeah? What about it?
I don't know.
Let me say something that's sort of generic. I know some of you spend a lot of time working on stuff that we put a bullet in the head of. I apologize. I feel your pain. But Apple suffered for several years from from lousy engineering management. I have to say it. And there were people that were going off in 18 different directions doing arguably interesting things in each one of them. Good engineers, lousy management. And what happened was you look at the farm that's been created with all these different animals going in different directions, and it doesn't add up. The total is less than the sum of the parts.
If you're not focusing, if your product team is not focusing, if your company is not focusing on a few areas, you're sort of just creating a whole mess and nothing adds up. Also, your customers don't know what business you're in. Now, there's a whole conversation around, and this is something that's even Scott Galloway talks about, that how much do you vertically go and horizontally go before your brand begins to dilute itself. For example, American Express was always seen as a very exclusive card. Limited people had access to it. But now they've introduced products which are accessible to a much wider audience. By that definition, it loses the brand value that it originally had. I guess I went on a slightly different tangent. But essentially, Steve Jobs is talking more about things that you need to focus on. Instead of doing everything, focus on the things that work and things that add value to the core. If I had a dollar for every time someone in a product company said, maybe we should add one more feature.
So we had to decide what are the fundamental directions we're going in and what makes sense and what doesn't. And there were a bunch of things that didn't. And microcosmically, they might have made sense. Macrocosmically, they made no sense. And you know, the hardest thing is when you think about focusing, right? You think, well, focusing is saying yes, no. Focusing is about saying no. Focusing is about saying no.
And it's not about saying no to things that you don't want to do anyways. It's about saying no to the things that you really want to do, but don't make sense to your strategy, to your vision, to your focus. This holds true even today, 100%.
But lately, Apple seems more apologetic about being different than it is proud about being different. And as a developer, you start to feel the same way. And I just wonder, you know, 15 years after...
Apple's perceived as much better.
The next point that Steve Jobs is going to make around being better, being much better versus being different. Now, of course, you want to be differentiated from your competition, but you also want to be relevant. That is the key. You want to be different, but you want to be relevant to your audience. So you don't want to end up being so different that the audience is lost and doesn't even care and you have no customers. So you still want to be relevant to your customers, but be differentiated, sticking to your vision and focus.
Because if Apple just says, we're just like everybody else, but better, that really doesn't say anything at all.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's good that Apple's perceived as different. I think it's important that Apple's perceived as much better. And if being different is essential to doing that, then we have to do that. But if we could be much better without being different, that'd be fine with me. I want to be much better. I don't care about being different. We'll have to be different in some ways to be much better.
If you get the right strategy, if you have the right people, and if you have the right culture at your company, you'll do the right products, you'll do the right marketing, you'll do the right things logistically and in manufacturing and in distribution.
So he's saying that you have a top-down approach where you have a clear strategy in terms of what you're going to focus on and what your vision is, and then you bring in the right people, build the right culture around that, and that is a home run. They're going to build the best freaking products.
Not on financial reengineering, because that's not what's been troubled at Apple. We're focusing our energy on the right product strategies, the right market strategies, the right communication strategies, the right logistics and distribution strategies.
Here's a little pro tip. If you want to be a fantastic designer, always, always think like the CEO of the company that you're working with, because that person is thinking about everything, not just visual design. They're thinking about making salaries. They're thinking about employees, culture. They're thinking about product, market, competition, stakeholders, media, press, perception, shares, company valuation, operations, logistics. If you're thinking like the CEO of the client that you're working with, you're just going to have a completely different perspective and approach to delivering outcomes and value every single time. Then you're going to ask the right questions. You're going to be curious. You're going to want to learn more. You're going to have a four-dimensional perspective of not only that business, but which industry it sits in, which sector it sits in, what universe it sits in. That is ultimately the secret weapon to becoming the most amazing creative professional when working in this field, in this industry, is to always think like the CEO of that company, because that person is thinking about everything. And that's what you have to also think about. That is the mental model that I apply. That is the framework that I apply to every client that I work with is to think like the CEO, the owner of that business. This next interaction I really like because it demonstrates how well Steve Jobs is handling criticism from the journalist and taking negative feedback.
Did it hurt to have your people, the people who, you know, love you, boo you like that?
I didn't know this was People Magazine.
No, well, you brought it up yourself. You said emotionally.
You
had a different reaction.
No, I mean, I don't feel my job is to win a popularity contest right now. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel my job is to help the team at Apple do the right things to turn this company around so that it can really prosper again. And I think that's going to happen. And if some people, the markets, we're talking markets now that are so large that there's, you know, someone or some group of people that aren't going to like just about anything we do. But my job's not to win a popularity contest.
I love how he handles critical feedback. I don't know how many people get this wrong where they think that just because a company has 5,000 employees and they have so much money that they probably have everything figured out. But if they don't have a clear vision and a strategy and a focus, all of them are working in their own silos, in their own direction, and not adding to the sum of parts.
Apple is executing wonderfully on many of the wrong things. The ability of the organization to execute is really high, though. I mean, I've met some extraordinary people at Apple. There's a lot of great people at Apple. They're doing some of the wrong things because the plan has been wrong. Yeah, I can't get anyone to tell me the definitive market share number for Apple, but it's around 7% from all I can gather. And the question is, where is Apple relevant? Where is Apple still the dominant player? Which market segments? And there are two. The first one I call creative content. It's publishing.
This is so beautiful. This is from 2 decades ago. And the strategy that he's describing is pretty much spot on with the way Apple markets itself today. Apple focuses on students, educators, and creative people. They're razor sharp focused on who their audience is.
And Apple is still the dominant leader in education. Now, I'm gonna ask you a question. Who is the largest education company in the world? Yeah, the answer is Apple. Apple is the single largest education supplier in the world. And what's interesting is Apple is still the dominant market leader for creative professionals. By far. It's like 80% of the computers used in advertising and graphic arts, design, pre-press, all Macintoshes. And 64% is the best number I could find. 64% of all internet websites are created using a Mac. But we haven't been doing a good enough job here. As an example, there is something like 10 to 15% of Mac sales, which can be traced directly back to people using Adobe Photoshop as their power app, right? When was the last time you saw Adobe and Apple co-marketing Photoshop? You know, when was the last time we went to Adobe and said, how do we make a computer that will run Photoshop faster?
Masterclass, finding meaningful partnerships. Not looking at people in the industry as competition, but as your allies. I mean, I'm saying that also because in the same conversation, he's talking about partnering with Microsoft and getting a $150 million investment from Bill Gates. He has a pulse on who his customers are, but what other stakeholders in his universe he needs to collaborate with. Beauty, masterclass, masterclass. So in a nutshell, what is Sandeep Goyal and Steve Jobs telling you? They're saying, number one, the big game mentality is about vision and focus. Don't let the distractions take you in many different directions. Stay razor sharp, focus on your vision. And it's about all the things that you're not doing and choosing not to do. All the things that are so compelling, but you're saying no to them. This concept is so simple, and it's about answering that why. Why do we exist? Who do we exist for? Despite all the processes and models and frameworks, you can boil down strategy to simple W questions. Why, what, when, where, who? 3, strategy and vision has to be top down. 4, culture and getting the smartest people in a room. If you're a designer and if you're a creative professional, you're a consultant, put on the lens of the CEO that you're working for. Think about all the things that they are concerned about, they're worried about, their challenges, their dreams, their aspirations. That's just going to make you a much better advisor and consultant, being truly client-centric, customer-centric. And finally, don't complicate stuff. Keep it simple. The why, what, who, when, where. Answer those questions and you are already on the right path. I'll see you in the next one.